everyone.
Aslama.
Marhaba. My name is Sana, and I am the director of Womenpreneur Organization. Today, I'm taking you with me to a journey of Womenpreneur Tour. Womenpreneur Tour is a collaboration between Senat Entrepreneurship Academy and Womenpreneur. We're going to travel to Morocco, Tunisia, and Jordan. We're going to meet with tech entrepreneurs, tech innovators, top leaders in the field of digital, blockchain, research, and science. The MENA region has the highest youth unemployment, and this rate is higher among women. In the MENA region, only 6% of women are in top management position. Only 6% of women entrepreneurs in Jordan are generating revenues that exceed 100K. We have only 25% of women entrepreneurs in Tunisia, 14% of women entrepreneurs in Jordan, and only 10% of women entrepreneurs in Morocco. 25% of women entrepreneurs in Tunisia operate in social and cultural sector. And 71% of Tunisian women who started their enterprises started with zero resource and zero support. There is a serious issue when it comes to women's participation in economy in the region. At the same time, there is an interesting observation when it comes to women's participation in technology. You would be very surprised if I tell you, in every three tech startups created in the region, one of them is founded by a woman. This number, we don't even see it in Silicon Valley.
For these reasons, Womenpreneur and Sanad Entrepreneurship Academy joined forces to promote female tech entrepreneurship in the MENA region through the first of its kind empowerment campaign, giving visibility to women in tech, innovation, and entrepreneurship, and provide platforms to assess the current state of the tech ecosystem in the region through Womenpreneur experience events.
So who are these women and what inspired them to start their tech ventures?
This is Ala Agakars.
Khadija Jalouli.
Lamia Tazi.
My name is Ala Hamdan from Jordan.
Amwala Kasmi.
Je suis Zineb Brissi Kaitouni.
Hi, my name is Amal Abid.
Je suis Yasmina Mounchkroun.
أنا تمارا عبد الجابر.
I'm Asra Al-Sana.
My name is Hidayat.
My name is Niyama Al-Basuni.
My name is Samah Al-Afif.
Lamia Ibn Makhlouf.
My name is Zahra Slim.
Rima Diab.
My name is Leila Bershan.
My name is Iman Bershan.
Amira Shanyour.
Amal Saidan.
أنا شام.
وأنا جنى.
Je m'appelle Marine Dahmoud.
Fatam Zahra Bereish.
Je suis Samia Shalvi.
Mona Latouf.
أنا اسمي دينا شاور.
اسمي إيمان حيلوز.
نوال شرايبي.
سيهام فايدي.
I'm Rasini from Tunisia.
I get married when I was in a very early age. I was like 15 when I got married, and I got my daughter when I was like 17 years old. I got divorced when I was 18 because it wasn't like that marriage that you can say it will stay forever. I was outside of the country, outside of Jordan. It was devastating and really hard. After that happened, I stayed for 1 year at home, and I was depressed, doing nothing. Until that day that my grandmother came to me and said, okay, Ala, are you taking a long time doing that? Because you're still 18, you still have life. I said, but my life stopped. She said, okay, continue from where you stopped and you have to do something else. That's why Superiors started. The vision was to do something similar to Twitter, similar to Facebook, this kind of level of application that need that entrepreneurial mindset, at the same time, the skills that I have.
So I always had difficulty to move long distance every day, always needing my parents or taking taxis to go because the infrastructure and public transport are not suitable for people with a disability like me. So I wanted to get a vehicle for me from abroad, but it was a little bit difficult. Why don't do it? And then in 2016, I decided to start this project. Well, Hawkar comes from the hawk, you know, the bird, hawk. He's free. He has a freedom to fly wherever he wants. I chose this word. So the
to
name.
To reflect on your
yeah,
project.
Yeah, to reflect it.
dans ma famille et parmi mes amis proches. J'avais une partie de certains qui m'ont beaucoup encouragée et d'autres qui étaient beaucoup plus réticents, qui justement voyaient que je prenais beaucoup de risques en fait, parce que je laissais une carrière, des perspectives de carrière plus qu'une carrière, une perspective de carrière intéressante où je pouvais accéder à des postes, en tout cas qui m'assurent une sécurité financière. Alors que là, j'allais me retrouver sans revenus, à avoir du mal à subvenir à mes besoins seuls. Et donc, c'était pas tout le temps facile, en fait, d'être résilient et de s'obstiner en fait à vouloir continuer à développer le projet quand on a effectivement une partie de son entourage qui est pas toujours encourageante.
We also met experts from the tech ecosystem, from finance institutions, and actors from government and policy making.
What are their biggest problems and challenges in the ecosystem in their countries?
Mais ce que je dirais, c'est que quand je me suis lancée dans l'entrepreneuriat, certes, ça n'a pas été évident, tout simplement parce que le contexte marocain n'est pas un contexte, je dirais, où tous les facteurs contribuent à encourager la femme à entreprendre. Tout simplement parce que les barrières à l'entrée sont déjà assez élevées. Il a fallu beaucoup, beaucoup, beaucoup de persévérance, je dirais, et de patience de ma part pour vraiment comprendre qu'il fallait déjà maîtriser cet environnement, mieux le comprendre pour pouvoir réussir. Je dirais que, certes, aujourd'hui, la femme au Maroc... La moitié de la population marocaine sont des femmes, mais seuls 10% des femmes sont réellement entrepreneurs au Maroc, qui reste un taux assez bas.
So I think like one of the main things that I found initially difficult was when we tried to fundraise was a bit difficult in Morocco, but that was in 2016. The ecosystem is starting to slowly change, but I think it's going to take a bit of time because it's not only about money, but it's about mindset. And often when you talk to angel investors or others, often the right mindset isn't necessarily there because of the way they assess what a startup should be. So, you know, you have investors who will be like, oh, what is my guarantee? And essentially as a startup, as an investor, there is no, like, it's not a real estate investment. It's not, there isn't a collateral or that kind of guarantee. But that's starting to change slowly, especially as there are more success stories internationally. But I think the main, sort of the big game changer will eventually be a success story in Morocco. Once there's a success story in Morocco, which has actually resulted in higher returns on investment for different types of investors, then I think it will be a lot more interactive in that sense. So that's sort of that's financing. I think it will change, you know, it will change and it's slowly changing. I think there's obviously regulatory constraints. Mm-hmm. So different types of constraints. So for example, one of the things that I've always wanted to do is basically when you hire people to give them stock options, because I do believe that everyone should be an owner in the company. By being an owner in the company, you will go much faster and you work really as a team towards that same aligned vision. That's very difficult to do in Morocco. Okay. Because we are essentially sort of a, legally speaking, an American company, just on paper. And so being able to give stock options with capital controls and stuff is very difficult. So these are things that if they could be made easier, it would be actually a lot easier to even attract talent into startups.
One of the components of FCBEX is the hardware, and we need to always to import what we call embedded components. And this, sometimes we don't find this in Tunisia, we need to import it from abroad, yes, exactly. So it took us like 2 days to get to France and then 2 weeks to come to Tunisia and to test and to validate and to pivot if we need. It's not very efficient, smooth in terms of activity of research and development. This is one thing, so we were like, weren't lucky to get the right ecosystem to be able to do research and development. Till now in Tunisia we have to work a lot on this.
So out of 600 startups who have registered, who have taken the time to fill in their questionnaire, we have 10
women's startups, which is a disaster. So we need the equivalent data in our region, in our countries, so that we can support the business case. What we know as well is like 60 or 65% of university graduates are women, and they are outperforming men in universities. But we know as well that in C-level positions in tech companies, you'll find only 5% of C-level are women. So it's like, where do we these women go? So there is, where do they disappear on the way up to the boardrooms?
I would say that there are a few things that are missing in general. One is certain technical skills. It's very hard to find technical skills. If you're looking to start a new tech startup, you have a cool idea, it's hard to find a tech co-founder, a CTO. Finding the tech resources is very difficult.
من المشاكل اللي بنواجهها بكل مكان عمر. إنه حتى إذا أجينا بدنا نفتح الستارت اب بتاعتنا إحنا تحت ال 18، إذا أجينا بدنا نشارك بمسابقات إحنا تحت ال 18، حتى إذا فزنا بمسابقة ممكن إحنا تحت ال 18. هاي من المشاكل الكبرى. والمشاكل الأخرى إنه إحنا بنشتغل بالتعليم والمدارس مش كتير قابلين فكرة التكنولوجيا تدخل على التعليم، فبيكون عندهم شوي تحفظ إنه خلص حابين يضلوا على التقليدي اللي متعودين عليه، إلنا سنوات كتير عم نشتغل مع التقليدي فخلص بدنا نضل عليه.
As I said at the beginning, I think one of the big challenges is that the law itself is highly discriminatory, and all sorts of laws are highly discriminatory. So whilst having a law that guarantees some kind of equality in the labour market, but also in terms of your rights vis-à-vis other people.
Je pense que les femmes ont peur de la technologie et peut-être à tort. Aujourd'hui, de nos jours, les femmes ont beaucoup apporté sur le domaine de la tech. Parce que les femmes représentent une certaine force, c'est l'empathie.
Là, effectivement, c'est une grande réalité. Nous n'avons pas de data, mais même le peu de data que nous avons montre qu'il y a ce manque d'entrepreneuriat. Déjà, je dirais, au-delà de l'entrepreneuriat tech féminin, un manque d'entrepreneuriat d'innovation. L'entrepreneuriat au Maroc est plus un entrepreneuriat traditionnel et d'opportunité.
The tech field is not a field where, and STEM in general is not a field where women are very much represented here in Morocco, but I think it's also true in the rest of the region.
Well, I think the first part is the family pressure. The family pressure, which is both for men and female, but for women it's more like the risk idea is more, I would say, available. Like the families are usually more afraid for the daughters to travel.
Did they find the right support and the right resources to start their businesses?
So because we are services based, it's usually very hard to find funds for such projects. Services are usually self-funded and they are depending on the income from each project. Unless you find like an angel supporter or investor, it would be amazing. But generally, it's challenging.
And I would say in terms of the support, you probably have been following the news about the Startup Act. It was a big deal for Tunis. And it was a collaboration of more than just one entity. It was a collaboration between the public sector, the private sector, like a lot of entrepreneurs that I know, and even including us, like kind of following on what's happening around the legislation that Luc was coming up with. I think that was probably the highlight of a collaborative work to provide something of substance to the entrepreneurial ecosystem in Tunis.
Lately, we have just changed the labor law. Wherever there are 15 parents, males or females, so we don't make it a positive discrimination that will allow negative unemployment of females, because if you make it only females, then people choose to only employ men. Yeah. So 15 parents in a working place, they need to have a daycare. By law.
Both men and women.
Men and women. And
that's
actually,
amazing.
That was my first decision in this ministry. I opened the daycare. It was my first decision. It was right after Eid. I asked them, do we have a daycare? They said no. I said, let's open it.
How did they raise funds to start their tech businesses?
We tried to look for the funds, but each time it's like it doesn't fit with what we do. Actually, they don't consider what we do education, because there's a part of it
fun.
Is, yeah, they consider it to be fun and to be recreational. Nobody considers it to be educational.
Fundamental.
Yeah, and fundamental and something that is basic and needed. So every time we go to look for programs that could ideally fund us, they would say, oh, this program, you don't fit, or it just, for now.
Actually, after a while, when you are when you are ambitious at the beginning of the project, you think that you might find some help somewhere. But I'm talking about our personal experience. After a while, we just were disappointed of all the support that was given in the field. Like even the banks, they have these great programs for entrepreneurs, but when you go to a bank, they just don't consider even opening an account bank for an entrepreneur.
Yeah, when you, for example, you want to apply for a loan even on your personal account, they tell you, no, we can't give you a loan because you have a company. And I'm like, yeah, but I am like every single person. I have a salary. I am an employee of my own company. But they tell you, no, you have a company, so you're not eligible to get a loan.
Unfortunately, we don't have the impact investors who give you money in order to come up with an impact. So that was challenging, especially at the beginning. It was really hard. Maybe because I still don't see that we do have the mentality that can cope with the environmental challenges and understanding of the importance of the environment, I might find it easier to find investors outside.
Alors non, j'ai pas reçu de fonds. D'ailleurs, quand je t'ai dit, j'ai même pas été accompagnée. J'ai lancé l'entreprise. Le contexte lui-même, il n'était pas, comme j'ai expliqué, en fait, c'était par nécessité, parce que je travaillais sur un projet, il fallait structurer les choses. Et j'ai lancé avec 24 dirhams, parce que j'avais 24 dirhams dans mes poches à l'époque.
Wow.
En fait, moi, j'ai quitté mon job avec une promesse d'embauche que j'ai vite fait décliner, parce que c'est pas du tout ce que je voulais faire. Être dans le salariat quand j'ai voyagé et j'ai eu l'opportunité de décrocher et de signer l'événement de Safi, donc là j'ai lancé la boîte alors que j'avais réellement littéralement 24 dirhams.
The main funding is Series A. It came mainly from Africa Invest, which is a Pan-African VC with a lot
established
of ties.
Established here in Tunisia,
yes,
right?
Established
for
in
those
Tunisia.
Who don't
yeah.
know.
Yeah. I can say that the entire Series A was $7 million.
$7 million. That's a big fund.
Yeah. فعدد المستثمرين الموجودين بالوطن العربي اللي بيستوعبوا فكرة إنه التك ستارت اب محتاج كتير إنه الواحد يستثمر فيها بالبداية من غير ما يكون في عائد على الاستثمار والعائد بده 10 سنين لبين ما يعني يبدأ عن جد يفرجي النجاح. يعني إذا بتطلعي بالعالم يعني على الشركات اللي نجحت كتير زي مثلا فيسبوك تويتر انستغرام واتساب كل هاي الابليكيشنز الموجودة تطلعي على تاريخهم بتلاقي إنه هم أول 10 سنين ما كانوا يعملوا عائد يعني على الاستثمار.
En fait, en Tunisie, les entrepreneurs, généralement, ils trouvent vraiment une difficulté pour accéder au financement. Par exemple, c'est à cause de leur zone géographique, parce qu'il y a une population qui souffre du manque de support financier dans certaines régions, et aussi à cause du niveau de l'éducation. Donc, et les banques aussi, ils demandent parfois des garanties qui ne sont pas très souples. Donc, c'est vraiment très difficile pour les entrepreneurs d'avoir des crédits.
Do you think that there is a certain mindset or gender bias where, you know, unfortunately, it doesn't allow women to access?
So I hear that a lot from you know, female entrepreneurs. However, one, there's a risk that this is all in our head because we're, you know, it's a challenge, obviously. And I think, you know, investors, even their mindset is changing, but we still think it's you know, for any reason that we are, you know, not allowed that investment, we think that it is because, you know, we're females. So it might be all in our head with some investors, but for the investors that actually do discriminate, I always say that these are not the type of investors that you'd want to invest with you.
I think that in Tunisia, like anywhere in the world, in the Arab world, let's say, the most challenging part is the lack of business opportunities for women. It's also the mindset of women entrepreneurs and this kind of self-confidence to be able to create a startup or a project that can grow and can be scaled
on an international level.
Do women and men have equal opportunities in the Arab ecosystem?
Et malgré ça, je voulais tenter ma chance aussi. Donc, mon choix, c'était de l'entrepreneuriat. Mais quand même, je voulais avoir de l'expérience dans le monde du travail. J'ai passé quelques entretiens, j'étais admise dans quelques-unes. Mais ce qui m'a marquée, c'est plus un entretien que j'ai passé où on m'a dit directement, on a un candidat. Et on sait très bien que... On m'a demandé aussi sur le mariage, est-ce que vous allez vous marier et tout. Wow. Donc on m'a dit directement, on va voir si le monsieur ne revient pas. Et si on l'accepte pas, on va revenir vers vous. C'était direct, peut-être...
Second choice.
Oui, exactement.
In my own experience, I never, when I was doing what I was doing, I never thought about me being a woman. So because I've always been a woman, so it's when, like in specific situations or dealing with specific people, that they tell you that they put the spots on you being a woman. Especially, for example, there is something that I heard a lot, which is binti, means you're my daughter. So you go, you want to talk to, you are a CEO, you want to talk to a CEO of a bank or any other structure, and he starts the discussion by Aish binti or binti, saying you are my daughter.
Most of the businesses are centralized in the capital in Amman. So women from the governorates, mm-hmm. they don't have access to the same
opportunities.
For example, I'm from Jarash and I'm living in Jarash. For me, I can handle coming every day back and forth to Jarash, from Jarash to Amman and back forth. But for other ladies, it's not feasible for them. Yeah, it's not convenient.
Il est plus sur le terrain travail. Quand il rentre à la maison, monsieur est servi. Donc c'est comme ça, c'est la culture, en tout cas, dans laquelle on évolue aujourd'hui. Alors que la femme aujourd'hui doit faire ses preuves et à la maison, parce qu'elle a toujours ce fardeau, et dans le milieu professionnel. Et donc là, c'est un autre challenge, parce qu'elle doit être disponible, hein, que ce soit chez elle pour gérer les enfants et le foyer, ou que ce soit dans son milieu professionnel. Elle doit faire ses preuves. Et pour faire ses preuves, il faut faire beaucoup de choses que l'homme a la facilité de faire, mais la femme non. Et je donnerai des exemples liés par exemple au réseautage. Comment une femme peut faire des connexions professionnelles si elle ne part pas dans des événements, si elle n'assiste pas à des conférences, si elle ne fait pas des formations. Parfois ces formations sont à l'étranger. Et ce n'est pas toujours quelque chose de bien conçu ou bien comprise par l'homme qui est son mari.
So far, what I saw that maybe men are having a better opportunities of getting investment. Really,
why is that the case?
I don't know. Maybe the investors, they think that they believe that the men are much hard worker than women. That's why they maybe prefer men than women entrepreneur.
So what are the recommendations to make the tech ecosystem and the ecosystem in general accessible and fair to women?
First of all, لازم يكون عندنا special regulations for women, to be honest. يعني لازم يكون في تعليمات وقوانين واضحة تدعم المرأة في مجال عملها, سواء كان يعني إحنا لما رحنا على سيليكون فالي اكتشفنا إنه إحنا هون ما عم نشتغل زي ما هم بيشتغلوا في الاستثمار في العنصر البشري, وإنه يكون مرتاح الموظف. يعني رحنا على فيسبوك, على تويتر, على جوجل, كلهم بيشتركوا بنفس الانفايرومنت اللي هي انفايرومنت مريحة للعامل والموظف.
Aujourd'hui, il y a quand même ce plafond de verre qu'il va falloir briser, hein, qu'il va falloir briser un jour. C'est vrai qu'il faut améliorer, il faut continuer à renforcer les capacités des femmes dans les sciences et dans la technologie. Il faut casser le stéréotype selon lequel souvent on associe les hommes à tout ce qui est sciences, des mathématiques, physique, chimie, au détriment des sciences humaines et sociales qu'on attribue souvent aux femmes, pensant que les femmes allaient être plus intéressées par
la prise de décision au niveau macro, au niveau stratégique.
Parce que c'est très, très important. Parce qu'aujourd'hui, certes, la femme entrepreneur, mais la femme entrepreneur, si elle n'est pas au niveau de la prise de décision, elle va subir aussi. Elle devrait être impliquée dans la prise de décision stratégique au niveau politique. Donc aujourd'hui, on devrait aussi penser à ce que, pour que la femme en tech, donc elle soit bien positionnée et elle trouve, donc c'est, elle vit ce challenge comme il faut et elle soit vraiment rentable par rapport à toute l'économie, il faut qu'il y ait aussi de l'entrepreneuriat politique.
Please stop being afraid and, comme on dit en français, lancez-vous.
Et donc, ce que je vois, ce que je pourrais proposer, c'est l'amélioration du process de recrutement au sein de ces entreprises-là. Ils peuvent donner plus de chances à la femme, être à l'écoute de leur, de ce qu'elles peuvent donner de plus dans ce domaine-là. C'est-à-dire que c'est pas uniquement, est-ce que, des questions comme, est-ce que tu es mariée, est-ce que tu risques d'avoir des enfants, c'est plutôt changer ce process et mettre en évidence ses compétences.
I think people need to listen to what women entrepreneurs need. There are a lot of different programs that are targeted to women that have been extremely helpful and extremely beneficial, but I think they need to talk to women that are on the ground, that are struggling, and hear their voices and what are their real concerns, because a lot of times these programs don't cater fully to women's struggles.
Well, first, the educational system needs reform. That's unquestionable. And we should not just expect the government to change the system. It's a collective effort from us youth who need to initiate and who need to be part of the movement, but also we need the collaboration of the civil society and the government to try to listen to us and take us seriously and trust us and try to implement a new system that is compatible with our needs and with the modern age needs.
Sur une loi qui oblige d'avoir un certain quota de femmes dans les conseils d'administration. Et pour moi, c'est une bonne manière de mettre les femmes au niveau de l'entrepreneuriat.
More of loan guarantee programs. I think clarity on laws and regulations, tax exemptions, ease of doing business. Easier procedures for registering companies, enacting the home-based business law. A law has been issued actually to support home-based business, but unfortunately it needs a bit of a push in practice and in making sure that the women get the benefits out of it.
Mettre quand même des quotas. Des quotas dans les ministères, des quotas dans les structures publiques, des quotas dans les banques publiques. Donc là, ça va même au niveau du financement, même au niveau de la bureaucratie. Même, moi, je pense que ça peut donner un coup de souffle.
Pousser, impliquer, donner des modèles aussi à des femmes pour qu'elles se disent « c'est possible ». Parce que je pense que c'est ça, en fait, souvent le frein, c'est qu'on se le donne soi-même. C'est que les femmes se disent, mais est-ce qu'il est possible d'entreprendre? Est-ce qu'il est possible d'être autonome? Et je pense que nous, qui avons dépassé ce stade-là, c'est notre job, notre rôle, en tout cas, de les influencer, si on veut.
Des choses qui donneraient, qui formeraient, qui renforcent les capacités des femmes pour qu'elles ne soient pas hésitantes, pour qu'elles foncent, pour qu'elles avancent, etc. Et puis, il y a aussi des lois, peut-être, à revoir. Il y a des lois sur... des lois importantes sur le gender, peut-être, qu'on doit réviser. On doit vérifier, je ne suis pas très sûre.
And for the MENA region, where women comprise more than 50% of the population, their inclusion, their participation in economy, in all aspects of society, is essential. However, women are still suffering from lack of opportunities, limited access to fair and equal education, inadequate access to funding and investments, lack of access to network support, and unfair family and tax policies block women. But one of the most important issues in the region is mindset. It's the culture that still views women and sees women in a very traditional way. But the world is changing. More than ever, we are uncertain what technology can bring to our societies. It's already changing our systems, our economies, and also our perspective about today and tomorrow. The MENA region, more than ever, needs to rethink the way it sees and it views women. the way it includes and involves women in every sector of life. With more than 50% of the population that is left out and marginalized, we are losing talent. Empowering women in economy in the MENA region is not only an economic right, it is a human right. The MENA region needs seriously to question and examine the way it perceives women. It's going to take us more than 200 years before we have equal societies. So what can you do to take part of the change and make the MENA region an equal and fair place?